Hi, welcome to this Ignite webcast, and thanks for joining us. My name is Josh Topal, and I'm a program manager for Office 365. And Ignite events are a series of technical workshops for IT professionals and Microsoft partners. And these Ignite webcasts will address different technical subjects and scenarios that are really beneficial to anyone who wants to increase their knowledge of the Office 365 suite. So today we're really excited to have Mark Fugit here leading us on our webcast. Mark is a senior premier field engineer for Microsoft in the UK, and he's been working at Microsoft since 2004. And in today's webcast, Mark will be teaching us about modern public folders. And so today's session really provides a great opportunity to hear directly from a Microsoft employee with such deep knowledge with Exchange. Today's webcast will be about an hour, and we'll leave a few minutes at the end to field questions from anyone on the call. And you can type your questions into the link chat box presentation below. And so one last thing, though, is we ask that you do hold those questions until the end for the Q&A. And also, we will be recording today's session, and we'll have the recording and the PowerPoint available right on at that link there where the blog post was originally posted. But that's it for me. So, Mark, whenever you're ready, feel free to take it.
Okay. So welcome, everybody. I hope you can hear me okay. So my name is Mark Fugit. I'm one of the premier field engineers in the UK working with Exchange and Link. So as Josh said, today's session we're going to be talking about modern public folders in Exchange 2013. So what we're, the objectives really and the takeaways for this session, really we want you to get an understanding of what we've done with public folders in Exchange 2013. What decisions you need to kind of make around what we store and where we store it. So is it applicable to store certain types of data into public folders? So we'll talk about the architecture of public folders in 2013. And we'll also touch on migrating public folders from legacy versions of Exchange, so 2007, 2010, across to 2013. And also onboarding those in the cloud on Office 365 as well. We'll also get to some demonstrations, so we'll run through the interface and how we set public folders up and how those work, so you'll get to see that as well. So really the key takeaways that we want from this session are that, that public folders are still there. So in 2013, you know, we've still got public folders, and we've made significant changes to the way in which public folders are architected in 2013, so we'll touch on that. And obviously we want you to make sure that you understand what's new in the architecture and what pain points that's addressed. So we listen to customers' feedback from older versions of Exchange and what they didn't particularly like about public folders, and we've kind of taken that into effect. So we'll be touching on that and looking through that as well. So public folders in server 2013. So we can now have public folders in on-premise, and we can also host those on Office 365 as well. So, you know, the concept, as far as the user's concerned, the end user's experience hasn't really changed in 2013. So the end user will still actually see the public folders in the way that they're used to seeing those. One of the things that to really point out here is that the fact with Exchange 2013, we've also introduced the concept of site mailboxes. Now, site mailboxes are not the same as public folders. So the concept really behind the site mailboxes is that they will hook in with SharePoint and give us a much better collaborative capability. So we can set up a team site in SharePoint or people working on a particular project, and then we can associate site mailboxes with that. So, you know, we've increased the collaboration capabilities with Exchange 2013. So one of the big things, of course, is when do we use public folders, or what do people use public folders for? So, you know, in my experience working with customers and also working with large organizations is that public folders kind of became a dumping ground for any kind of information, whether that be documents, whether it's calendars, whether it's contact lists. You know, historically, it's kind of, well, if we're not sure what to do with it, we'll just throw it inside of a public folder and we'll leave it there. Now, with Exchange 2013, we've got better capabilities. We've got better features to enable us to collaborate. So we've got things like site mailboxes, which we've mentioned briefly. So this gives us the capability of working within a team. So if we've got a team site or we have a team working on a particular project, then we can use SharePoint and we can have a site mailbox for that. We've then got shared mailboxes. Again, you know, historically, we might have a shared mailbox for our sales team, and they can all interact with that shared mailbox. And of course, we've got distribution lists. And public folders are obviously still there. But really, with the advent of site mailboxes, then we can actually use those in a much better way for collaborating on particular projects. So we still have shared mailbox capabilities, we still have distribution lists, and of course, we still have public folders. So what do we get with public folders in an online scenario, so Office 365 scenario? Now, obviously, depending upon the feature sets that you are using within your organization, you will get access to public folders. You will be allocated space for those public folders. So one of the main things, of course, is for organizations to consider how are they going to use that space effectively for mailboxes and obviously for public folders as well. So there's a significant amount of space available for tenants to utilize Office 365 for their public folder content. Obviously, Microsoft will manage the storage. So you migrate your public folders from your on-premise environment and you can then put those into the Office 365 environment. And then Microsoft will obviously take care of the management of the storage and obviously the allocation of that storage. One of the other things, of course, with Office 365 is that Microsoft will take care of load balancing the public folder across that storage as well. So really, moving public folders to the cloud gives you or frees up you from that administrative overhead. So cross-premise, so if you have on-premise and you have cloud, any of your cloud mailboxes will still be able to access your on-premise public folders. Users that have got Exchange 2013 mailboxes will access the public folders in the cloud. So we can either have on-premise mailboxes, on-premise public folders, and then our users accessing them from the cloud, or we can have our 2013 mailboxes accessing their public folders in the cloud as well. So we've got coexistence there. We can do the tenant administration. So using the Exchange Administration Center, you will be able to administer your or perform folder management using those tools as well. So, you know, you don't lose the capability of your administrative features there. So what's new with public folders? Well, quite a few things, really. First of all, migration. We can migrate our public folders from 2010 or 2007. So we can move from Exchange 2010 or Exchange 2007 and bring our public folders into Exchange 2013. And we'll talk more about that a little bit later. We have cross-premise access, cross-forest access. So one of the things just really to point out here is that if you have an Exchange 2013 mailbox, then you can only access, or you can access the public folders in Exchange 2013, or you can access the legacy public folders as well. If you are on Exchange 2010 or 2007, so if your mailbox is currently hosted on 2010 or 2007, you cannot access the 2013 public folders. So really, if your mailbox is in Exchange 2013, then you can do a combination. If your mailboxes are on 2007, you can only access, you can't access the 2013 public folders. And this is more important when we come to do the migration, which we'll talk about shortly. We have the ability to access our public folders through OWA, and we'll do a demonstration of that shortly.
Did everyone else lose audio? Yeah, I think Mark's link is giving him issues. Sorry, let's hold on 1 second. We'll, looks like he's trying to join again. Yeah, thanks for your patience. Looks like he's back on, I think.
Yeah, sorry about that.
Send me your address, Ryan.
My.
No, it's okay. No problem. You are back. We could hear you. So, yeah, feel free.
Okay. Sorry about that. Okay. So, as we're saying, we can access our public folders using Outlook Web Access, and we'll do a demonstration of that shortly. Sorry about that, just take over the presentation again. Administration of our public folders. We can use the Exchange Administration Center to do our administrative tasks. And of course, we can still continue to use PowerShell to do our administration as well. So we haven't lost the capability there. Public folders and mailbox restores. So one of the big, obviously the big change with 2013 is that public folders are basically mailboxes. So we have the ability to do soft and hard recoveries using the client, the same way as we could recover emails, we can also recover folders, and we can also recover the public folders from there as well. So we've got new recoverability features with Exchange 2013 there. We've got the full text searching capability for public folders. And we've got automated storage management for service customers. So Office 365, when it comes to load balancing the public folders, then that's obviously taken care of as well. And again, we'll talk more about that as we get through to the architecture side of things. So in terms of accessing your public folders, from a client standpoint, pretty straightforward. Office 2013, Outlook 2013, Outlook 2010, Outlook 2007 plus the relevant update. So it is important with 2010, 2007, if you are using Exchange 2013, to make sure that you've got all the relevant public updates installed on those clients. So not just service pack levels, but also make sure you've got the public updates applied as well. We can obviously use Outlook Web Access as well. As we've already mentioned, from a server standpoint, if you have your user is on the 2013, they can access the 2013 public folders, 2010 and 2007 public folders. If you're running legacy mailbox, so 2007 or 2010, then you cannot access the 2013 public folders until you've been migrated. So when you are thinking of migrating from 2007, 2010 over to 2013, public folders would be the last thing you'd kind of bring across. upwards to migrate the users to 2013, and then we'll actually do the migration from your legacy 2013 for the public folders. So migration support, again, we will talk more about this, but we can cut over from 2007, 2010 to 2013, and we'll run through the steps of how we would do that. So what I'd like to do is just do a quick demonstration of how the public folders actually look and how we can administer them in Exchange 2013. So I'm just going to switch across to my second monitor, and hopefully it will play nicely. Okay, and what I'm going to do is we'll just bring up the administration center. So hopefully you can all see that. So what I've done is I've actually logged into the administration center on my lab here. And what you'll notice is that we've got the public folders option available to us. And when we click on the public folders, we're then presented with the screen you can see now. So the first thing is that if I look underneath my public folder mailboxes, we can actually see what mailboxes I've actually created for public folders. So in my lab here, I've only got the one mailbox for my public folders, which is my first public folder mailbox I've created. But inside of that, I then have a number of actual public folders themselves. So what you can see here is I've actually got four public folders side of the public folder mailbox that I created. Now we can also see if those folders have subfolders. We can see if they're mail enabled, and obviously we can see what mailbox they're stored into. So what I've got here, you can see that I've got a folder called company notifications. It's telling me that it's got some subfolders. So if I click on that, then I can actually see that I've then got a subfolder called sales targets inside of my company notifications public folder. So the first thing, of course, to notice is that we have a mailbox. That mailbox then contains the public folders. Okay. So let's just go back up a level, and we'll take a look at marketing. So if I look inside of my marketing public folder, I've got a subfolder called incoming marketing emails, and we can see that it's actually mail-enabled. So we can still mail-enable public folders if we want to, and we can obviously do the permissions here as well, so we can manage our permissions from here. So creating a new one is pretty straightforward. If I just click on the plus, I'm going to give it a name. And then we'll click on save. And I've now created a new public folder called Test Public Folder. It doesn't have any subfolders and so on. If I wanted to create subfolders, just make sure the path is actually set to be Test Public Folder. And then we can create a new one. And there we go. So now we've actually created a Test Public Folder, and it automatically tells me that there are subfolders because I obviously created one in there. So the creation of public folders, pretty straightforward. Of course, we can do this using PowerShell as well if we wanted to. Now, from a user's experience, if we just take a look at a user here, so what I'll do is I'll just up a client. I'll just log in again. So if I go into OWA, so this is the OWA session for Terry, and what Terry can do is actually go to the favorites in OWA, right mouse click, and he's now given the option to add public folders. So if I click on add public folders, you can now see that we've actually got a list of the public folders that are available, and we can choose which one we'd actually like to add to our favorites. So I've added the incoming marketing emails public folder to my favorites. So when Terry clicks on that, then obviously he's got access, and he posts new messages as well as he wants to. So if I was to post a new message, that would be in there. This is a test. We can post that. So what we've now done is now created a new message inside of that public folder. Now from an Outlook, so that's obviously from Outlook web access, from an Outlook standpoint, we can go down to and expand the folders option in Outlook, and we'll obviously then get a list of the public folders that are available to that user. So we can then obviously navigate, and we can see the hierarchy, and we can see the messages from there. Okay, so I've just switched back to the session there. So you can really see from that demonstration that from an administrative standpoint or from a user standpoint, you know, public folders are pretty straightforward to manage with Exchange 2013. Now, the architecture of the public folders, as we've already mentioned, public folder databases are basically mailboxes in Exchange 2013. Now, what this means is that we can make use of the high availability features of Exchange for public folders. So one of the big complaints we had from customers around legacy public folders was the complexity in terms of replicating data across the enterprise. So what we've now done is we've integrated that into the database availability groups. Because they're mailboxes, then we can have those mailboxes replicated, or those databases replicated as part of the database availability group for high availability features. Now, in the older versions of Exchange, then public folders were based around the multi-master scenario. So we would have public folders replicated across multiple servers, and then data was being written and changes were being made to those copies, and they would then converge and obviously replicate data. With Exchange 2013, from a hierarchy standpoint, there is only one master copy of the folder hierarchy. We'll show you a little bit more about that, you can see. So we've now got a single master replication for the public folder hierarchy with Exchange 2013. So this slide kind of shows us how that works. So if you notice, I've actually got three public folder mailboxes. I've got the primary public folder mailbox, secondary. The primary is the first public folder mailbox that I actually create. That becomes the holder of the hierarchy. So that's the writable copy of the hierarchy there. The other two public folder mailboxes that I've created will have a copy of the hierarchy, but it's not writable. And they can then contain their own folders. So in the example, we've got three separate mailboxes, public folder mailboxes. The first one we create holds the hierarchy. The other two will have a copy of the hierarchy, but they can also have their own folders inside of that as well. So we can actually split those across. So as far as the user's concerned, there's really no changes to what the user sees. But the main thing now is that we've got database availability groups to deal with replicating the content, and we've also got the single master for the hierarchy. Now, from a storage and scale capability, obviously, in the example here, we would create our new mailbox, and we would designate it as being a public folder. We can also do that using the UI as well. So in we've actually got three public folder mailboxes. Now, each one of those public folder mailboxes would obviously have content in them. So we could have content in those public folder mailboxes relating to different folders. is that your user base is probably going to expand. Users are probably going to utilize public folders more, boxes, so the size is actually going to increase over time. Now, what we can then do is we could create more public folder mailboxes. The hierarchy gets automatically copied across. So remember, we've got the primary public box, which holds the hierarchy, and that will then be copied across to any additional public folder mailboxes that we create. And then what we can do is we can actually create more folders, we can add more content, and we can actually split the public folder. We can split the mailbox public folder across those two different folders. So over time, as it grows, then we can actually split the content across multiple databases. So it's there to basically help you with your storage and scale capability. So there is a script. There's a script called splitpublicfoldermailbox.ps1, which will basically take roughly 50% of the content and move it across. So, you know, you can configure it as well, but it will actually give you the capability of targeting a public folder and actually splitting that content across multiple public folders. So it will take folders across. So in the slide you see here, we've actually got on the first public folder, we've got three folders, and we've got one that's actually got five messages in it, five pieces of content. We could then split that, and we could move that across to the second copy. So now we've actually split the content to give us more scale capabilities. So the split public folder mailbox database, split public folder mailbox script is extremely useful for that. Now, migrating. So obviously, moving from legacy versions of Exchange, so 2007, 2010, over to 2013, as we've already mentioned, public folders would really be the last thing you do. So you would have brought all of your users from 2007 or 2010, they would now be hosted on 2013, and then we would actually bring the public folders over as the last step, really. So before you actually start the migration, so before you actually even press any buttons, a couple of things we want to do. We need to make sure that our legacy environments are running the right version. So we need to make sure that we're running Exchange 2010 SP3 and Exchange 2007 SP3 with at least roll up 10 before we can actually do the migration successfully. So make sure all of your existing servers are running at the appropriate level. Make sure that you've got no replication issues now. So looking at your legacy environment, if you are facing replication problems, then you need to resolve those before we start migrating that to 2013. It's not going to be a good experience if you currently have replication issues on your legacy environment. So do a health check of your current environment to make sure you've got no replication problems. As we already said, migrate your users to Exchange 2013 on-prem or to Office 365. And then we cut the public folders over. So we as we've already said, we don't kind of phase this in. Once we've brought the users over, we then bring the public folders. So there will be a short period of downtime why we make that switch. So when you're doing your planning, obviously just take into account that there may be a slight delay in actually getting or a little bit of downtime that you'll need to experience there. So once we've actually completed the migration, then all of the users would now be accessing the 2013 version of the public folders as opposed to accessing the legacy versions. We also choose to switch some users over, first of all, just to validate that, you know, public folders are working properly. So before we do the big bang, then we can actually just bring a few users over, get them to test it out. We also have the ability to do a rollback. So you can roll back from 2013 back to the legacy. The only thing to mention around that is that any changes that were made to the 2013 folders do not roll back. So rollback is basically at the point in time that the legacy public folders or what they looked like at the point that we did that final switchover. So if you do roll back, any changes made to the 2013 environment's public folders do not roll back. They don't go back to 2010 or 2007. So the actual steps of migrating from 2007 or 2010. So at the moment, you can see from the slide here that we've actually got our Outlook clients are just looking at the 2007 or 2010 public folders. We've actually got three databases here. So we've got a public folder database 1, 2, and 3. And what we want to do is we want to bring those across to Exchange 2013 or bring them across to Exchange Online or Office 365. Now the steps to bring to migrate to Office 365 are pretty much exactly the same as we're going to look at here, with a couple of little extra steps. And at the end of the session there's a TechNet link which will give you more details about what is required to migrate those public folders. So what we've now done, or what we need to do first of all, as we've already said, all that our current Exchange environment is the pack level and the right roll-up level. So Exchange 2010, SP3, and Exchange 2013 with the roll-up 10 at least. We would have migrated our users, so migrate the users across 2000, and also do some analysis. So, because we need to know how much data is it that we're actually going to be migrating across. So what are the implications on storage in 2013 of what we currently have? So the first thing we can do is take a snapshot of your existing public folder structure. And there is a script available. So there's a script called Export Public Folder Statistics, which will actually export your current public folder information to a CSV file. So it will show you the public folder names and the size and how many items that are in there. So if you use the Export-Public Folder Statistics script, that will then create a CSV file for you, and that's basically the snapshot of your existing environment. We can also then use another feature, another script, which is called Public Folder to Mailbox Map Generator. So these are available. And what this will do is it will take the CSV, the output from the Public Folder Statistics script and use that as an input to the Public Folder to Mailbox Map Generator. And that will give us the ability of seeing how many public folder mailboxes we will need new environment. So we're taking a snapshot, but we're also using that data to give us the structure of what the public folder mailboxes will look like in 2013. And those are configurable, so you can actually change the parameters in there as well, and you can make adjustments to that accordingly. So the next step is to create your public folder mailboxes, or to create however many you need. Now when we create them, we can then actually, there's a number of ways we can do this. We can do them individually, one at a time, or we can actually use the mapping file that we would have gained from using the mailbox map generator script, and we can actually use that to create the public folders in 2013. Now, when we actually create these public folders, what we want to do is make sure that we put them to what we call hold for migration. So when we create them, there's an attribute called hold for migration, and we would set that to be $true. Because what that means is that we don't actually want people to start using these public folders. So they're there to do the migration. We don't want users accessing them at this point. So we can begin the migration process. So we can actually then start to migrate the public folder data from our legacy environment across to 2013. And we can do that by using the new public folder migration request. So there's a commandlet called new public folder migration request, and we can actually use that to bring the data over. So when the data, once it's completed copying the data across, then it actually sets that request to be auto-suspended. So we haven't finalized the migration at that point. All we've done is brought the data across from our legacy environment across to 2013. So once we've actually brought the data across, we can then finalize the move. So the first thing we do is that we'll lock out the users. So we'll actually use the set organizational configuration commandlet, and there's an attribute called public folder locked for migration, and we set that to be $true. So that's basically when we're going to suffer this little bit of downtime, because we've basically locked public folder access at that point. Now that's for the legacy and it's for the new. So once we've actually locked it, we will then finalize the synchronization, and we can then resume the request at that point. So once we've locked it, we can then use the public folder migration request and actually basically complete the synchronization at that point, and we can then unlock it once that data has been moved across. So, you know, the important things really is to make sure that you lock it so users aren't in there accessing it while the data is being moved across. And little animation. Okay, so monitoring and diagnostics. So, obviously, troubleshooting public folders is always a fun experience. We've got the get public folder mailbox diagnostics commandlet, and this will give us the ability to access the per mailbox sync and the assistant logging log files. So we've got the capability of accessing those log files and seeing if there's been any replication issues or any synchronization issues from that. We can also do a force of the hierarchy. So we can update public folder mailbox and use the invoke synchronizer attribute there to actually force synchronization to occur. So if you are experiencing what looks like hierarchy issues, then one thing to obviously do is to force it, so invoke the synchronizer, and then obviously take a look at the log files and see if there's anything in those log files that could identify why synchronization might not be occurring the way it should. We've got the MompTE and we've got the EWS log files, so they will be in the logging directories, so we can access those and see what kind of logging or any issues that may have been recorded in there. And again, we can use the get public folder migration statistics, the get move request statistics, and the get public folder move statistics commandlets to give us information about the mailbox splits that have occurred. So as we mentioned, we can actually split public folders across. And we can also get information about the move requests themselves and obviously about the public folder move statistics as well. So there's lots of commandlets in there to help us look at the log files, troubleshoot what those problems may be relating to. So for Office 365, we've got the active monitoring probes and there's the automatic storage management features as well. So those are all part of the Office 365 components there. So really from a troubleshooting standpoint, it's a lot easier troubleshooting Office Exchange 2013 public folder issues than it was with the legacy versions because we've now got a lot of the commandlets and the replication concept is a lot more simplified. So hopefully you're not going to run into huge numbers of problems around replication of public folders. So some of the related content, some great stuff there on TechNet, and we've also got the Exchange Teams blog. There's some good posts there about public folders and what's new in public folders in 2013. And there's also the TechNet Wiki as well, which has got information about public folders there. So, you know, some great information out there about public folders. But the main things to remember, of course, is that public folders are now mailboxes. The first mailbox you create holds the hierarchy. That hierarchy is a single master component. So we only have one writable copy of the hierarchy. The others hold a copy of the hierarchy. And obviously the content can be distributed across more than one that we've got there. Okay, so that's pretty much the end of the presentation there. So I think we've got some time to get some questions answered and look at what questions have come through on the chat. So there's been quite a few on there on the chat that's come through.
Yeah, thanks, Mark.